Welcome, everyone. As Melena said, we're very excited you're here. Thank you for joining us. Good evening, good afternoon, depending on where you are. This is our second workshop in our Schoolyard Habitats webinar series. There'll be two more during the rest of the school year. I want to introduce myself. My name is Sarah Ward, and I'm the Schoolyard and Community Habitats Program Manager in New York City. I'd also like to respectfully acknowledge that I'm gathering on the unceded territory of the Lenni Lenape people in what is now known as New York City. I want to pay respect to their elders, both past and present, who have been stewards of this land throughout many generations. And our co-host tonight is Melena, and I'll let her introduce herself.
Hello, everyone. Hola a todos. And thank you for joining us tonight. And I'm from originally from Puerto Rico, but I've been in Miami, Florida for the past 3.5 years. So I want to acknowledge also the original peoples from this part of the country, the Miccosukee, the Taino, the Seminole, and the Tequesta people. We're so grateful to be standing here in their land. My position in NWF, I'm the Florida Education Manager. I manage the Eco School USA and the Schoolyard Habitat Program in South Florida since 2018.
Right. So here's our agenda for the evening. I do want to let everybody know that we are recording this webinar, and we will email it to you in a few days after the end of it. So at any point during the webinar, please add questions to the Q&A, and we'll have a chance to answer them at the end. We'll leave about 10 to 15 minutes at the end for questions. So we're welcoming you right now, and then Melena and I are going to spend a few minutes discussing outdoor learning. What does it look like? What can it include? We'll also give a brief history of outdoor learning in the US, as well as discuss some of the benefits of it. And then we'll get to the really good part, is that we will hear stories from three amazing educators from across the US. We'll go to Georgia, outside of Atlanta, then we'll travel back to Brooklyn, and then we'll land in Texas, outside of San Antonio. So I'm really excited to introduce you to these three amazing educators who use outdoor classrooms or who are planning to use outdoor classrooms this school year. And then, as I mentioned before, we will leave plenty of time for your questions and to hear more from all of the three teachers.
All right, so we wanna go over our NWF, or the National Wildlife Federation's mission, which is to unite all Americans to ensure that wildlife thrive in a rapidly changing world. And if you would like to know more information about the National Wildlife Federation, please visit our website, www.nwf.org. Next slide. A little bit about the Schoolyard Habitat Program. This program started in 1996. Almost 10,000 schoolyards are certified to date. That's a huge number. And I know we exploded during the pandemic. A lot of teachers went outside and certified their schoolyards as a schoolyard habitat. So we know this program is having an impact during this hard times of COVID. The Schoolyard Habitat Program is a standalone program. You can run it at your school as an independent program from NWF, or you can also work it as an environmental pathway of sustainability under our Eco School USA program. And certification is free for schools. So we encourage you that if you're not certified yet, your school as a Schoolyard Habitat, to go ahead and join this program. So what is outdoor learning? For us, for me as an educator, the outdoors is a classroom. This can take hundreds of different shapes and forms. It's super varied depending on where you are, if you're in an urban area, suburban, or the time that you have. But what I want to take away from this is that there is not one set way of thinking of the outdoor as a learning space. It can take any shape or form depending on what your interest is and what is available to you. Next slide. Outdoor education can be defined as anything encompassing education outside of the classroom. Outdoor education can be simply defined as experiential learning in, for, or about the outdoors. The term outdoor education is used broadly to refer to a range of organized activities that take place in a variety of ways in predominantly outdoor environments. It can be informal learning, it can be formal learning also, and it describes curriculum learning other than with a class of students sitting in a room with a teacher and books. So outdoor learning, this is outdoor classroom. In outdoor learning, this modality uses the community or natural environment to enhance student learning. Examples, we have environmental education that you can do outside, garden education, or experiential STEAM or STEM learning, which is very popular right now. And then outdoor classrooms is considered a gathering area, not necessarily engaging with the environment as part of student learning. So it can be just that one day you decide to take your classroom outdoor and have lunch out there, or you can have a reading circle that has nothing to do with the environment, the story, but you just want to take your class outside, and that's an outdoor classroom. That becomes your outdoor classroom for the day. Next. So I want to do a very compressed history of outdoor learning. And for me, one of my favorite educators is Maria Montessori from the Montessori education system. This was one of her most famous quotes: when children come into contact with nature, they reveal their strength. Next slide. Another quote that Maria Montessori was very famous for was that nature is our first teacher. So Maria Montessori always encouraged to take learning outside. She believed that children's observational, organizational, classification, and data collection skills were developed naturally when using the outside environment. In the 1920s, Maria Montessori turned her attention to the adolescent stage of children. She observed that at this stage of development, students needed activities that helped them to understand themselves better, to find their place in the world, and to blossom into global citizens. And she proposed residential schools where young adolescents, whom she called children of the earth, they could work and live in a trusting community, engaging in real world activities such as farming or marketing their own handmade goods. By experiencing interdependence between humans and nature, she believed that students will learn how society is organized and develop the skills needed to meet the world's challenges in a positive way. Next slide. Okay, so a little bit about open air schools. These open air schools were part of a larger open air school movement which began in Europe with the creation of the forest schools for sickly children in Germany in 1904. It was known as an open air therapy for urban youth that had pre-tuberculosis. Classes were taught and fed in the forest surrounding Berlin. And the movement quickly caught on and it spread throughout Europe and North America in 1906, more or less. Then open airs were purposely built educational institutions for children that were designed to prevent and combat the widespread of rise of tuberculosis and other diseases that occurred in the leading to the Second World War II and the Spanish flu in 1918. The schools were built to provide open air therapy so that fresh air, good ventilation, and exposure to the outside would improve the children's health. The schools were mostly built in areas away from the city centers, sometimes in rural locations, to provide a space free from pollution and overcrowding. But later, with the advancements of antibiotics and vaccines in the 1940s, these schools started to wane down and started to disappear. And basically by the 1950s, they were almost gone. But now with the COVID-19, the pandemic, outdoor classrooms or open air classrooms have had a resurgence all over the world.
All right, so there are so many benefits to taking learning outside. And as Milena just alluded to, one of the major benefits right now in this moment we're in is that it's safer. While we're in the midst of a pandemic, we know that there being outdoors reduces the risk of virus transmission, but there's also opportunities for inquiry-based learning, for hands-on learning, as well as environmental stewardship and play. In communities that don't have access to safe green spaces, these outdoor classrooms, whether they're school gardens or wildlife habitats or nature play spaces, they can also provide a vital connection to nature. So here's just a few of the many benefits. There's physical, social, and emotional benefits during the pandemic right now, as well as in the future. Research shows us that when children spend time outdoors, they're healthier, they're happier, and they're more successful in school. There's a lot of opportunities for social emotional learning. There's a lot of opportunities for restoration and healing, especially to address some of the trauma that we've all experienced during the last year and a half. Okay, so now we'll transition to hearing from our teachers. Our first teacher that I'm so pleased to introduce you to is Dr. Candace Little. She's an environmental science teacher from Arabia Mountain High School, which is a suburb of Atlanta in Georgia. So take it away, Dr. Little.
Dr. Little, you'll have to unmute.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm so sorry. I'm just so happy to be here. I do agree with Maria Montessori in reference to nature being a good first teacher for students, because it certainly was a first teacher for me. I spent countless hours outside with nature. As a child, I remember being 5 years old, living in the state of Utah, and just being out there with nature. We had very large grasshoppers with beautiful wings. I would feed them grass. I would disrupt the ant bed and watch them put it back together. I would put insects in jars just for a little while. I didn't let them die, but just observe them. And I have no idea why I was so connected with nature, but it certainly allowed me to explore much more. Thankfully, my mom was okay with it. But as a teacher, and this is probably the reason I became a teacher, because I love science so much and I love nature so much. It's just worked out to my advantage and really to my students' advantage. Right now, I am working at Arabia Mountain High School, which is the newest high school in DeKalb County. It was developed in the year 2009, and it is a LEED certified school. And you can see from the slide, LEED stands for Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, and is certified on the silver level. It's the only high school in Georgia that is LEED certified. And there's a interesting story behind that. Some of the lumber companies that are not certified and who could not be used to help provide the wood for our school, they went to their legislature and they kind of did away with the ability for public buildings in Georgia to be LEED certified. That is definitely a project that I plan for my students to take on and follow that trail and see what we can do about changing that. Also, our school is on an EIC model. And EIC stands for using the environment as an integrating context for learning. This was started actually in California. And I'm just so thankful that our school had the insight to follow this model. The land that was provided for our school is on 2,500 acres of land. And it's part of the Arabia Mountain National Heritage community or property. The Arabia Mountain Heritage area, it encompasses 40,000 acres. So they donated 2,500 acres for our school. And it's just tremendous. So in order to really know anything about the land that we're on, we really have to go outside. And I have wanted to do more by myself, but I've done quite a bit with my students going outside and just exploring, really. This is my first year at Arabia Mountain. And so there's a lot that I don't know yet. So just exploring has been part of our agenda for right now. And we have plans to do many more things on the property connected with National Wildlife Federation. When I knew that I was going to start working there, and this is my first full year in the classroom at Arabia Mountain High School, I knew that I wanted to reach out to the National Wildlife Federation because I had worked with Earth Tomorrow as a sponsor at a previous school. And it was the best idea I could have had because I contacted the leader there and she told me that she was getting a promotion and that someone else would be taking her place. So I asked her if she would come to our school and visit and so that we could kind of brainstorm some of the things that we could do. And when she came in, she had with her her replacement, who was Brendan Barclay, who I had known, I'd met 20 years ago when he was dealing with urban forests. And as a teacher, I had actually brought my students to his urban forest. So we hit it off right away and came up with some great ideas. And one of the students from Arabia had already been trained in leadership for Earth Tomorrow. So of course she's our president. And we have a group of students that are running the Earth Tomorrow Club. We did get a grant early in the year for $1,000, and that's what this picture is showing. And with that grant, we have three projects that we are going to be working on. And one of them deals with gardening. So that's going to definitely get us outside. And we've received our funds and we're going to start purchasing the materials that we're going to be able to use for the garden. But little did we know that we really could have focused on our outdoor classroom because as you can see, it's in major disrepair right now. I took the students out there just to show them the before, and they're actually gonna be a part of creating the after because we've already planned on doing some community service after school or on the weekends to clean it up. We're contacting local community members to see who is willing to help. We've written a few other grants and one grant that is being written with us as a part of it through the Environmental Education Grant for the EPA. And that is one that Brendan's organization is writing, and we will be a part of that grant. And it's going to provide us with an opportunity to really do some great things at our school. Our students love being outside. One of the challenges is taking them outside and completing our curriculum as we are supposed to. But as time goes on, I know we'll find creative ways to do that as well. I'm just excited about the opportunity.
So sorry to interrupt.
To it. Yes.
You have one more minute.
Okay. Well, I'm just excited about this opportunity. I look forward to learning more from the other panelists, and I'll be open to any questions that you guys have.
Thank you so much. I know that as a New Yorker, when I hear that you have 2,500 acres on your school campus, I just can't even imagine. So I'm really excited about what you all may do this year. All right, and so our next teacher is Mr. Stephen House from John Erickson Middle School, MS 126 in Brooklyn, New York.
Beautiful, thank you, Sarah. And yes, Dr. Little, I'm very jealous as well, because as all of you know, here in Brooklyn, we have a very limited green space. And so it's mostly concrete in New York City. And with that being said, it's unique that we have such a nice garden, both in the front of our building and in the back of our building, that we use every single day. We created a pollinator patch as well as an outdoor classroom. And this past year during COVID or during the pandemic, the pollinator patch served to provide food, cover, and places to raise they're young for the wild bees, the butterflies, the moths, the beetles, and the hummingbirds. While our outdoor classroom is really a space that has several different raised flower beds, vegetable beds, we planted over 400 plants back there as a soil cycle, which is an aerated compost machine, as well as several different learning centers. And, you know, we use both of these spaces just as like to be a small part of our grand solution and providing these habitats for our pollinators in New York City, and to provide a green space where our students can become citizen scientists. Next. So what motivates me to use the outdoors for teaching? Wow, there's a laundry list to what motivates me. But I guess it's really the eagerness of the students to be outside. Every single day and with every class, the first thing they do when I enter is they ask me, are we going outside to learn today? So no matter what the curriculum is, whether we're focusing on an eco-school pathway or whether it's just embedded in our pacing, we go out we just give them different jobs. As you can see on the left, this is our schoolyard in the back. And in the front there and on the right, they're looking at different organisms from the pollinator patch. But really what motivates me is just watching them have fun, interact with nature, chance to see, smell, touch, and care for nature, which again, it's unique in New York City. And it's an access to a green space, clean air, water, and healthy soil, which in this pandemic is essential, because we're isolated right now in the building, and be able to get outside and put your mask down is a nice treat. Next, please. Sarah's gonna show you a video that was created of our students. And then we're gonna go into integrating the curriculum and then best practices that I would suggest. Because I've been doing this now for about 13 years, and we built this from bottom up.
All right, so everyone just bear with me for a moment as I switch to a video. Thank you.
This will, the video that she's posting or that she's going to put on right now, it just shows the progression of from start to finish of our pollinator patch. And in addition to us just creating this outdoor learning space, the kids gardening in the backs in the picture that you're observing on the left. So I'd be happy to explain what this looks like for later in the Q&A, but it's was quite the amazing process in the transformation.
Okay, sorry, everyone. I thought it was playing clearly. How's that?
So thank you, Sarah. So that was just like a little from beginning to the end video of the pollinator patch and the kids working over this past year. So, you know, our goal is to basically really just get them to engage as citizen scientists and to recognize their impact both locally and globally. And, you know, this comes with integrating the curriculum. So when I design our curriculum, I really build and design a year-long context based around the seasons here in the Northeast so that we can maximize our time outside. We also integrate all of the Eco Schools pathways into our year-long context accordingly or respectively as well. So something unique that we did at our school that was pretty neat was we created electives based on all of the Eco School pathways. So the students got to choose where they wanted to go to or whatever they were interested in. And then to help have them actually be part of the design process. So what is their mission? What problems are they solving? And then what does that look like? So for me, in my water club, for example, the students went around and they noticed in the building that all of the pipes were leaking all over the place. So they went in and they measured all of them and they calculated it, how much waste we have inside the building in a day. And then they brought this to the attention of the custodians, and it took about 2 weeks later, and then everything was tightened up and was sealed. And then they took it about one step further, and they said that we want to build a water catchment system outside in the garden so that we can water all of our plants and just recycle and reuse that water. So having the students be part of the process has really been integral in the success of this program. So best practices are creating and sustaining a schoolyard habitat that it really takes an entire community. I cannot stress it enough that you have to include every single stakeholder, the parents, the teachers, the aides, the custodians are so important, and the administration behind you. The community, have community events on Saturdays that we've had, and just to get the more people involved, the better. To build a diverse and community-based habitat early on, so to make it sustainable, it has been essential in our success, and to collaborate with all of our local sustainability partners here in New York City. It's Grow NYC's Million Trees. You know, National Wildlife Federation has been amazing. Eco Schools, so. It's been quite the experience. I feel so lucky to be a part of it. And I'm definitely the head lead. And I am so excited, just like the kids, to get out every single day and have fun in the fresh air.
Thank you, Mr. House. Yeah.
And I'd like to conclude with this is just to be flexible, have fun. But I also want to say that how important this green space has been to the social emotional growth of our students, because it provides that safe, calm space for them to heal, to collaborate with their friends, to put their masks down, and to just be kids. And so thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And I can attest, because one of the few bright spots in the pandemic during the last year for me was getting to help these students create this pollinator patch. And it is pure joy. And Mr. House would take those students out nearly every day, I suspect. I would even, there's a bike path next to the school, and I travel that bike path often, and I would just be riding by and see them out in the garden, and you can just wave to them. So they're very lucky kids to have you as a teacher.
Oh, well, thank you. And we're lucky to have your support and to have the green space.
All right. Thanks again. And our next teacher is Miss Isabel Anaya from Elotes, Texas. I might not have said that correctly, and I apologize, but I'll let you take it away, Miss Anaya.
Thanks, Sarah. Hi, everyone. My name is Isabel Anaya. I'm actually originally from East Chicago, Indiana, but have lived in San Antonio, Texas for the past 21 years. So I guess I should call Texas my home, right? I have one son. His name is Michael, and he is majoring in mechanical engineering at Texas Tech. My parents actually live in Michoacán, which I think that's where I gained my love and appreciation for nature, to be honest. A few years ago, I was blessed to be able to visit El Rosario, which we know that's where all the monarchs migrate. And if you have not had a chance to do so, I highly recommend it. I know Isaac is out there in the audience, and he can attest to that too. This year makes my 21st year working in Northside in San Antonio, Texas, and I have taught third grade and fifth grade, both at Title I campuses and affluent campuses. I'm currently teaching fifth grade at Coons Elementary, which is in Helotes, Texas, which is right next door to San Antonio. And I'm a teacher ambassador for EcoRise. I serve on the board for Keep San Antonio Beautiful, and then also host several after-school clubs, including solar cars and robotics and Theater for a Cause and EcoFriends, which is my environmental club, which I'm going to tell you a little bit more about. And they're actually the ones that drive me to do this even more. Over the years, we have created, in my opinion, a beautiful sanctuary for the monarch butterflies through the Monarch Heroes program. And now we're working to increase biodiversity by adding new native plants that are going to attract hummingbirds and other pollinators on their journey. We are adding shelter for our migratory birds species that often nest there, including purple martins. EcoFriends, which is my after-school environmental club, they're the ones that are responsible for maintaining our pollinator garden beds, as well as our vegetable garden beds. This year, I think marks our third, maybe fourth year with the Monarch Heroes program, the Eco Schools. And we're just using that resource to continue to add more native pollinator plants to our existing gardens, as well as focusing more on sustainability using the Schoolyard habitat pathways as well. Students participate in all kinds of different things in our school, including propagation stations. We call it Gardens for a Cause. Ways of giving back. So they have learned how to propagate our own plants that we have there through clippings, through seeds, through root division, and then finding organizations or schools that maybe are wanting to start a garden, but not sure how to start a garden, or maybe lack the funds to at the moment. And so we give those to them. During the pandemic last year, the students that were with me were able to propagate several of our pollinator plants, and we donated them to the Civil Rights Botanical Garden in San Antonio as well. They also participate in biodiversity audits and eco audits, and are looking for just different kinds of things to take part in. They put their skills to use as citizen scientists making observations. They use apps like iNaturalist and Seek and Globe and eBird and all kinds of different things just to make observations in their garden. You can go ahead, it's everywhere. We're good. Yeah. So as you can see in the pictures, those are our before and after, and a very similar story like Stephen shared. I mean, we were looking for a place, you know, when I first went to Kunz, it was just literally an open outdoor space. And so we were looking for an area to start something new. And I reached out to my principal and said, hey, this is what I want to do. I want to be able to, you know, help kids use that space a little bit more. And so they're the ones that motivate me. Their reaction when they step outside, you know, and I just see it full of life, the colors, the vibrant colors, the bees, the hummingbirds, all the monarchs, all the different variety of butterflies, they're my why, you know. So they're definitely the reason why. They always seem to find something new. You know how kids are, you know, they look outside, they see a new bug or a new flower or a new butterfly. And it just, it's something that gravitates them outdoors. Being able to create that space where they're able to connect with nature, they're able to see the beauty of it. They learn how to not be afraid of certain insects and instead learn how to understand how they're beneficial to our garden. And that makes them appreciate that space a lot more. So this transformation has happened over the past 12 years of me being at that school, but I could not have done it without the help of my students. It's their vision. And they're them putting the extra hours, like Steven said, you know, having them out there on the weekends and, you know, through hot summer days in San Antonio and still working out there. My suggestion for anybody who's wanting to start an outdoor learning space is to start small. Start small, have the students be an active part of it. Just as Dr. Little mentioned in hers, and having the students be out there and researching different areas and what that area is going to look like. It's definitely been a work in progress, but we absolutely love it and enjoy being out there. Go ahead, Sarah. There you go. So here you're going to see just a whole bunch of pictures from my kids and then other students as well, growing leaders, helping them find their voice, especially when it comes to environmental issues, is my why. The more students are exposed to nature, the more positive change that I believe that they can make. And exposing students to the beauty of nature and teaching them to understand environmental and conservation issues will help them to stand up to issues that arise. Students in my environmental club have participated in the sustainability showcase. And so they're the ones that are presenting And, you know, telling about what they're doing, telling about the biodiversity audits that they're participating in, or telling about their participation with Journey North and the symbolic migration, and or the Great Texas Birding Classic that we participated in, and, or all the gardening. And so just having them out there and reaching out to your community members is important. So those are my kiddos. Love them. And then go ahead, Sarah. And then in just finding different ways to integrate into their curriculum, I'm always looking for ways in which we can connect with concepts that deal with environmental issues. For example, this past year, the students participated in the symbolic migration through Journey North. And when looking at the monarch migration, they started to explore how climate change can affect the migration patterns of monarchs. You know, why we were seeing such a decline in monarchs, and is that connected to climate change? And so a lot of questions, you know, they started to wonder and ask about. We in the garden, we studied decomposition, and that led to students wondering why we don't have a compost bin. Maybe our next project, who knows? And then in math too. So there's always different ways, you know, measuring the space between plants, you know, why is that needed? And then just all kinds of different concepts areas. We use a lot of the iNaturalist, the Seek, the eBird, the apps that we have mentioned to kind of keep track in our data. A lot of it is hands-on, most important, just connecting them to nature, having them out there going and journaling, using any kind of real world experiences to teach problem-solving skills. EcoRise has a great curriculum out there too that we use, which is sustainable intelligence curriculum. And we do a lot of eco audits, and that helps us with funding in some of our projects in the school too. And then just last, some best practices, very similar to what the other amazing teachers have shared. Definitely community support, reach out to those friends and family to set up any kind of community garden days that you have. Reach out to local businesses. We had Snooze AM Eatery come out there with their snoozers, which are their volunteers, to help one day. Reach out to local Keep America Beautiful affiliates to help support too. We had volunteers from the Texas A&M AgriLife Extension programs come out, Bexar County Master Gardeners come out to also give presentations to the students. Again, just find those resources out there and reach out to them. Start getting the students involved, create a garden, even if it's a small one, you know, have them start out, you know, getting their hands dirty, and then involve the school for sure, you know, find opportunities to do school-wide programs, like we just created a bluebonnet stomp, or find ways to have the different grade levels adopt a certain area. That way they're able to see the benefits of using that garden. And then teacher training, you know, showing the teachers how to use the garden. You know, a lot of the times they're afraid of going out there, you know, so just offering opportunities to model to teachers, you know, and tell them about the plants that are out there, the benefits of the milkweed that you can't see yet, but it's going to come out later. And just, you know, just teaching them how to use that garden. Looking for funding, reach out to your PTA, reach out for grants. You know, your district has grants out there. There's a lot of other programs that are able to do that. Monarch Heroes, you know, definitely is a huge support in why our school is the way that it is. And then obviously administration and custodial support are huge. You need them to be your best friends. You know, you want that space out there, and, you know, you want to make sure that you smile at the custodians and tell them to eat those jalapenos that are out there. But more importantly, just have fun and enjoy nature. Connecting students is the most important part of it all, and just being able to appreciate and enjoy it. And, you know, as you heard from Stephen and Dr. Little, just taking the kids out there, you know, having them be part of it. So I appreciate you guys for listening, and I'm here to answer any questions at the end. See how it goes.
Yeah, perfect transition. Thank you so much. And now I'm so very excited that we'll be able to hear more from these three amazing teachers and to answer any questions you may have for them. So please feel free to add your questions in the Q&A, and we will make sure that they can answer them, that they have time for answers. So I'm gonna stop sharing so everyone can see each other. Hi, everyone. Thank you again for sharing. I'm so inspired. I love seeing all the pictures and the transformation. So we're just so grateful for you all to share these experiences again. So I will kick us off with the first question. You all showed a lot of success and a lot of amazing transformations on your school grounds, but I wonder if you could speak to some of the challenges that you've had taking students outdoors or anything that you've encountered with, just using the outdoors as a classroom. And maybe we'll go to you, Mr. House, first. How does that sound?
That sounds great. So yes, there has been a lot of challenges, obviously, with these projects like this. However, I guess, as Isabel said, start small. Timing has always been a challenge for us. Our classes are about 44 minutes. So, and every kid in every class wants to go all the time for science. So collaborating with other teachers and how they can kind of pick up where you left off or creating interdisciplinary connections allows them to be out longer. So timing has always been a big challenge. Also resources at the beginning, not really knowing where to start without a plan. So to plan in advance, to kind of, you know, I thought that personally, when I went out there to begin, I was like, okay, this is going to happen. And it doesn't at all, because you go out there and without knowing even the protocols that you thought that you had in place, things fall apart. But that's when you learn from those, and the kids reflect on these, and we talk about how would you guys want this to look different, and to really include them in the entire process. So start small, be patient, be very flexible. And again, like Isabel says, smile, because we're all outside and we're having fun.
Thank you so much. Dr. Little, do you want to add anything to that? Any challenges that you've experienced trying to get students outdoors?
Well, one of my challenges is actually doing some of the projects that we have proposed to do. And we actually have funding, but then to order the materials, to have the time to figure out where to get the materials from. And I saw some great things in the other presentations, the boxes for the gardening, where to get the wood from. So I'm just in the very beginning. We have potential to do really great things, but actually doing it. Loving the idea of it, but actually making it happen. But I'm very encouraged by Stephen and Isabel, because I see myself hopefully one day being able to say, we've been doing this for 12 years or, you know, over time, actually seeing the benefits of it.
And to go off of what Dr. Little just said, you know, Sarah with National Wildlife Federation has been very helpful with connecting us to the community partners, to who would build the flower beds with us, who, right, you know, who plan the timing. So they have been like instrumental in the development of this. And with her, with, you know, to have more, the more people, the better, the more stakeholders involved. Okay.
Yeah, and just ordering materials and sourcing things, that can be another part-time job. And I know you have a pretty full-time job. That's so right. Yeah. Isabel, do you want to add anything about challenges that you've had?
I think the biggest challenge is not necessarily taking the kids outside, because they love it. District and maintenance. So we've had a lot of issues with mowing areas that shouldn't be mowed, even those signs are out there, or shutting the water off, and then figuring out how in the world am I going to water all of this. And so that, I think that more than anything is some of our biggest challenges, But again, just continuing to reach out to the district, know who to contact, and then having that support from administration is big. So knowing that they have your back on issues like that makes it a little bit easier to deal with when you go to the backyard and things are mowed away. So.
Yes, maintenance is and management is always an issue of these places, and communicating about that as well. Yeah, especially because plants are always changing, and so things may not look the same after a few weeks. So we have a few questions that have come in the chat and in the Q&A, and I just saw one pop up that you know, especially as the seasons are changing, at least here in the Northeast, I know, in Atlanta too. So can you share any activities that you do in the off season? So that may be winter or maybe a dry season or a season that's even too hot to be outdoors. Why don't we start with you and Ms. Anaya, and we'll do a reverse order, or feel free to just pop off mute too.
Yeah, our off season is hot and hot and hot all the time in Texas. So, but we do have, our opportunities to do things inside. And so we do a lot of the eco audits inside of the school as well. So our students did an audit on, it's called Drip, Drip, Drip. And so they were looking at, I think Stephen actually mentioned something similar to that as well, looking for areas where there's water's being wasted. So at this, around the campus, they noticed, the faucets, not necessarily closing correctly. And so they did an audit based on that. They were looking at adding air plants inside of each of the classrooms so that it can help with circulation, especially during this pandemic time, So they're constantly looking for ways to do that. We still talk about propagation in the classroom too. So we're propagating by seeds, we'll talk about the different types of propagation. We did the symbolic migration through Journey North. And so that's one that you can continue to track in the classroom, look for different the migration patterns and what comes in and comes out. Just different environmental issues that you can look for is one of the ways that we use our time indoors, if it's too cold or if it's, we are not able to go, it's raining outside, and just constantly looking for those areas. Stephen?
Yes, very similarly. We do a lot of audits during the downtime. For example, our students came up with when focusing on all the eco school pathways, when it came to recycling or what for that specifically, they wanted to go around and they noticed that a lot of the teachers in their different classrooms weren't being recycled the proper way. So what they did was, they came up with the idea to give every single classroom a report card grade. So they would go around and they would do their recycling audits, for example, and they would go through the recycled bins versus the trash bins and all the above. And then they would stamp this huge letter on your door or right outside. So when people walk by, including our administration at once, and they give her a bad grade, the bad score, that kind of pushed people just to start to do the right thing. Like I told you with the water, we've had energy audits, but to really just try to also get them to think about like green design has been like a big thing with us, and to design what does the New York City look like, or what does, if we were to understand the different, even locally in the community, if we were to add different bioswales or green roofs to these buildings, and how much would that reduce and clean our air? So just to really tie the as many environmental aspects as we can inside, and then we can take that content, I guess, and we can kind of run it into once it gets a little bit nicer, but we're not out there in the winter. And even though the kids would, they will be, you've seen them, they put their jackets on. It was about 45 last week and they're still begging me to go out every single day. So if it was up to them, they'd find something to do outside. But we focus most of our efforts inside on the ECOS pathways.
Well, one of the audits that we plan to do for Arabia Mountain is to use the rubric that was used for LEED certification and see where we are now. The school was built in 2009. It has not been recertified, and we're going to see how well we're doing, if we're maintaining it, or if there are some changes that need to be made. And if so, you know, contacting Georgia Power, we're very close with them to see how we can get ourselves back up to standards.
That is such a great idea. I really would love to see the results of that audit. So yeah, please share that.
A nice thing to do in the lunchrooms that have been cool was that you have like different helpers every single week. And then, you know, they separate all their food. So they pour the liquid out, and then their food, and, you know, they recycle accordingly. And then they bring all that food into the compost, if you create a compost outside, and then they turn that compost over, and then they can use that over time to put back into the system. So I guess the more ways that you can get these kids to think about how can they support the bigger picture and what is their role and mm-hmm. their impact on their local community, their carbon footprint, you know, and everything, I guess that's the push, and that's the motivation. Because it's pretty cool when the kids have these epiphanies and they're so proud of what they've designed or developed.
Yeah, and I know we've reached time, so I do want to be mindful of everyone's time, but I want to acknowledge that I saw a raised hand. I think it's Ari. Ari, if you're still on and want to unmute yourself and ask a question, I invite you to do that. I apologize for delaying this. And the other question that came in the Q&A, I think would be a great question to crowdsource in our last minute here, is that someone asked about outdoor learning for Indigenous populations in the U.S. Are there resources to learn more about these practices and principles? So if you're watching and have any great resources about Indigenous, any Indigenous resources that you use in the classroom, I invite you to add it in the chat, and we'll be sure to share it with everybody in our follow-up email. And all of you panelists, if you have any that you've found useful, if you want to share now too, and then we'll wrap up. Oh, awesome. Thank you, Christina. Yes, the Lenape Center in New York City.
And I did answer that question in the Q&A, but for everybody else, one of my favorite curriculum books that has to do with Indigenous tradition is The Three Sisters Garden. So I will email you that the whole book name and the authors, so you can access that resource.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, and so we are unfortunately out of time. So I want to express my immense gratitude to all of you for sharing these photos, sharing your stories, sharing your experiences with us. You know, I was inspired by everything I saw and heard. And so I hope everyone else was inspired or learned some tips and tricks for taking students outdoors. So thank you so much. We're incredibly grateful. And as I mentioned, we'll follow up with everybody, share the recording of this session, as well as some of the resources. And we'll also make sure we, if we didn't answer a question, that we could follow up with some answers to those questions in the email. So I invite our panelists or anyone else to say any closing words. So thank you again.
I just want to say thank you for giving us the opportunity to share a little bit about what we have done in our space. We know that our kids are extremely proud of it, and we're extremely proud of it. And we hope that, you know, you take a little bit of what we have and start it, you know, your own garden at your own school and get the kids out there in nature too. So thank you for allowing us to be part of this.
Thank you.
I really appreciate being a part of such a great community. I look forward to spending more time with each of you all and learning from you, and hopefully I can share something meaningful for the group.
Yes, and thank you very much as well. It was a pleasure to be here. I've learned a lot actually from the two of you, and it's been a true treat to work with National Wildlife Federation, and their support has been amazing. So thanks for everything and have a lovely evening.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for being here.
Bye.
Have a great night.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Bye.